Hi, my name is Isabel Smalleganger, and in this talk I will present work I conducted with Marta Flotats-Aviles and Kim Eustache on how unusually paced life history strategies of marine megafauna drive atypical sensitivities to environmental change. The study that we conducted is centered around one of the main questions in population biology, which is, can we predict population responses to environmental change by life history strategies of populations? So let's look at types of environmental change. I will discuss two types of environmental change, starting with the time series of food conditions. So imagine an environment in which food conditions can be poor or rich, and these conditions vary over time. One day it can be poor, tomorrow it can be rich food conditions. And the way in which these food conditions change over time can be predictable or not. There can be high predictability in food conditions. If today food conditions are rich, tomorrow they're rich as well. Or predictability can be very low. Another way in which such a time series can be characterized is by the frequency with which good food conditions occur. So these frequencies can be very low, there can be very few occurrences of good food conditions, or the frequency can be very high, in which case food conditions are nearly always very good. Okay, so that was types of environmental change. Let's look at types of life history strategies. There are different types of life history strategies, but the one that I will focus on here is the fast-slow life history speed continuum. So imagine on the one hand where you see the elephant, there are the slow life histories. So slow life histories are characterized by low fecundity, a very late maturation in life, but high survival. And on the fast end of this continuum, we have life histories where you could think of rabbits, that have very high reproduction rates. They mature very young in life, but their survival rates are very low. Now we know from recent work that whether a species or a population is characterized by a fast or slow life history can be related to how these populations respond to shifts in the predictability of environmental conditions. For example, a cross-taxonomical study has shown across a wide range of populations of animal and plant species that the fast life histories are very sensitive to shifts in the predictability of environmental conditions. And this has also been corroborated by theoretical findings. Now, in this study, we asked the question, okay, what about marine megafauna? Do they follow this similar premise that fast life histories are very sensitive to shifts in the predictability of environmental conditions? And the reason we were asking this is because marine megafauna have some unusual life history characteristics. For example, many species can be characterized by high longevity and late maturity, which is characteristic of slow life histories. They have very low offspring numbers, again, a slow life history characteristic. But some species, so for example, if you look at sea turtles or particular reef sharks, they have very high offspring numbers, which is more characteristic of fast life history. So in this study, we looked at life history data of four mobulid species, giant manta rays, four reef shark species, and five sea turtle species. And we collected data from the literature on individual growth and reproduction to describe their energy budgets. And we also collected data on juvenile and adult mortality rates. And these data were collected from individual level observations. And we used these individual level life history data to parameterize a dynamic energy budget integral projection model that we then used to calculate quantities that inform on population responses to changes in the environment. So what is a dynamic energy budget integral projection model? It is a demographic model that tracks the changes in body size distribution through time, and these changes are controlled by the demographic rates of survival growth and reproduction. Now, survival is described as follows, as you can see here on the slide. So individuals of very small size, typically the juveniles, they have fairly low survival, whereas larger individuals, typically the adults, have high survival rates. Growth and reproduction is described by the Kooijman-Metz model, which is an energy budget model. It takes the trade-off between energy invested in growth and reproduction into account. So what you see here in this schematic is that this blue-tubed individual ingests food. The food that it has available is allocated to growth and maintenance, and any energy that is left is then funneled into reproduction. Now, what is key about the dynamic energy budget integral projection model is that the model parameters, they are not statistical coefficients, but life history traits. So the model takes as input parameters length at birth, length at puberty, for example, reproduction rate, mortality rate, and the von Bethe-Lampe growth rate. And how does it work? So like I said, a dynamic energy budget integral projection model, like any integral projection model, tracks the changes in a body size distribution. So here is a body size distribution. Now, over time, some individuals die. So over time, this body size distribution will decrease in size. However, individuals will also grow, so it can slightly shift its location. Individuals also reproduce, which means that over time, the frequency of the smaller individuals will increase. So from all these changes in the demography, so the survival, growth, and reproduction, we calculated for each of the different species that we studied the population growth rate. And since we were very much interested in how populations respond to shifts in environmental change, we looked at time series where food conditions varied over time. So here you see an example of a time series. Food conditions can be either poor or rich, which means that as populations move through time, their population size will change as a result of differences in food availability. Now, this change in the populations over time can be captured by the stochastic population growth rate. And if the stochastic population growth rate is larger than zero, it means that the population is growing in size. If it is lower than zero, the population is declining. Now, there are different ways in which such time series, as you see in the top right, can be characterized. In our case, we created this time series by defining two parameters, small p and small q. And these parameters are probability with which a population switches between food conditions. So the small p is the probability of switching from a rich to a poor food environment, and small q the probability of switching from a poor to a rich food environment. And with these two parameters, we can then calculate lots of different time series where food conditions vary over time. And because we have these two parameters, we can characterize these time series by the autocorrelation and the good environment frequency. So the environmental autocorrelation is typically characterized by the small letter rho, and the good environment frequency by the small letter F. Let's look at some of the results, starting with the frequency with which good food conditions occur over time. So on the left-hand panel here, you see the results for the four mobulid species, the giant rays. And as the frequency of good food conditions increases over time, so moving along the x-axis, the population growth rate of all species increases, which seems quite a natural thing to expect. If you look at the different reef sharks, as there's one reef shark that really stands out, that is the tiger shark, which shows a strong increase in population growth rate as the good food frequency increases. The other reef sharks show a less steep increase in population growth rate with good food frequency. And then the right-hand graph is the graph for the sea turtles. So here we see a very strong response where the stochastic population growth rate of all sea turtle species strongly increases as the good food frequency increases. Now, the another type of environmental change we looked at was environmental autocorrelation. And let's start with the giant rays again. So on the x-axis now is the autocorrelation, which values range from -1, so a high negative autocorrelation, to +1, which is a high positive autocorrelation. The value of 0 indicates that there is no autocorrelation. What we see here is that the stochastic population growth rate of the giant rays increases over the autocorrelation gradient. So moving from high negative values to high positive values increases the stochastic population growth rate for these species. Looking at the reef sharks, we see much less of a strong response. And the one again that stands out is the tiger sharks. It shows a hump-shaped response over this autocorrelation gradient. Finally, the sea turtles. There is hardly a response to shifts in environmental autocorrelation. Only at the very high values of autocorrelation, so the high positive values, does the stochastic population growth rate of the sea turtles decrease slightly. So, to answer our main question, which was if population responses to environmental change can be characterized by species life histories, we set out to link the life history trait parameters from the model to responses in stochastic population growth rate over the two types of environmental gradient. So here is a first example. On the x-axis here is the scaled maximum reproduction rate, ranging from 0 to 1. On the y-axis is a quantity that indicates whether species show a positive correlation between environmental autocorrelation and population growth rate, in which case the values are high and positive, or whether they show a negative correlation between environmental autocorrelation and the stochastic population growth rate. And what we see is that the faster life history species, so the sea turtles, the ones that show high reproduction rate, show a negative correlation between the population growth rate and the autocorrelation. Whereas the slower life history species, so the giant manta rays, show a positive correlation between population growth rate and environmental autocorrelation. And now we look at the second environmental gradient, the good food frequency gradient. On the y-axis are now plotted values that indicate a positive correlation between the population growth rate and good food frequency, and values close to zero that indicate no correlation between the population growth rate and good food frequency. These are plotted against a juvenile mortality rate. And what we see is that the faster life history species, so the sea turtles and the tiger shark, characterized by high juvenile mortality, are very sensitive to shifts in good food frequency. Whereas the slower life history species, so the giant manta rays and some reef sharks, are not sensitive to shifts in good food frequency. Plotting the same response variables, but this time against the von Betzlaff growth rate, emphasizes the same result again, that the faster life history species are sensitive to shifts in good food frequency, but the slower ones are not. So to summarize this up, we can rank the different marine megafauna species along a fast, slow life history continuum, and we can link their population responses to shifts in environmental change, whereby the faster life histories are sensitive to shifts in frequency. They're also sensitive to shifts in predictability, showing a negative correlation. The slower life history species are particularly sensitive to shifts in predictability, showing a positive correlation. So what does all this mean? We showed that both slow and fast life histories are sensitive to shifts in predictability, but this is in contrast to the previous work I showed in the beginning of this presentation. This could be due to taxonomic differences, or it could be due to the fact that we took an energy budget approach. And coming back to our main questions, can we now predict population responses to environmental change based on their life history strategies? I would say we're not there yet. And I would also like to emphasize a statement from a recent paper by Gallipo and Cocco that we should not lose sight of the fact that general life history patterns may not always be expected. Thank you for listening.